အခုအထူးအစီအစဉ်တစ်ခုတင်ဆက်ပေးသွားပါမယ်။ VOA American တန်ရဲ့ plug-in အစီအစဉ်တင်ဆက်သူ Greta Van Susteren ကပြီးခဲ့တဲ့ဇွန်လတုန်းက Bangladesh နိုင်ငံ Cox's Bazar မြို့အနီးက Rohingya ဒုက္ခသည်စခန်းကိုတွားရောက်ပြီးစခန်းခြေနေကိုမှတ်တမ်းရုပ်သံရိုက်ကူးခဲ့ပါတယ်။အပိုင်း၄ပိုင်းခွဲပြီးတင်ဆက်ပေးမှာဖြစ်ပြီးဒီကနေ့ပထမပိုင်းမှာတော့ဒုက္ခသည်စခန်းတွေရဲ့အမည်ပြင်းခြေနေကိုပြောပြသွားမှာပါ။ဒုက္ခသည်စခန်းမှာနေထိုင်မှုအခက်အခဲနဲ့ပြဿနာတွေကိုသိရမှာဖြစ်ပါတယ်။
It's the unthinkable. Nearly 1 million Rohingya refugees have been driven out of their homes and villages in Myanmar into neighboring Bangladesh. It is by far one of the world's largest humanitarian crises today.
The Rohingya are descendants of the ancient Southeast Asian kingdom of Arakan.Its borders face the Bay of Bengal to its west, the Indian subcontinent to its north, and Burma proper to its east, isolated by the Arakan Mountains and accessible primarily by sea.
In the 8th century, Muslim traders brought Islam to Arakan, where the religion spread. In the 18th century, Arakan was conquered by the neighboring Burmese people.
Until recently, the descendants of the Arakan, now known as the Rohingya, lived isolated from the majority Buddhist population in what is now called the Rakhine State of Myanmar.
But Myanmar denied Rohingya the right to citizenship, their basic rights to study, work, or access to health services were severely restricted. Beginning in 2012, Western leaders started to take notice.
In Rakhine State, we see the danger of continued tensions there.
Then, in August 2017, tensions between the Rohingya and the Burmese boiled over. Rohingya rebels attacked Myanmar security forces. The military quickly counterattacked.
The violence against civilians has forced more than 500,000 people to flee for their lives.
Hundreds have been killed. At least 200 villages have been burned to the ground.
The word is genocide.
We must shine a spotlight on these accounts of ethnic cleansing.
This is the story behind the catastrophic humanitarian crisis affecting Southeast Asia, and the story of the people trying to help the Rohingya.
Look around me. This river, it's part of the border between the nation of Bangladesh and the nation of Myanmar. It's a short distance from the Rohingya refugee camps.And this is one of the border locations where many desperate Rohingya refugees under the most unthinkable conditions cross this river, fleeing for their lives. There are about 1 million Rohingyas here in Bangladesh. They're living in very tough conditions with very uncertain futures.Not every Rohingya was able to escape to Bangladesh. Many, numbers unknown, were murdered, slaughtered. The United Nations has identified these vicious acts as ethnic cleansing. You've heard the phrase, never again. But those words ring hollow here. It has happened again.To the Rohingyas.
They came, one of the groups, to our village and then came to our markets and they looted all of the expensive things and then they set fire.
Also, they come into our village and shooting theEverywhere, just firing, like shooting, like this, on fire. No meet, no discuss, no question. Just shooting.
When Mohib Bula's village was attacked, he traveled for 8 days to reach safety.
I have heard that, that there was killing, shootings.
Yes.
Killings with machete.
Yeah.
Rapes of women.
Yes.
Do you know anybody who was killed by machete, shot, or raped?
Yeah, a lot of people we know.
When they burn in our villages and the market, that time I saw with my own eyes.
Did you see anyone killed with your own eyes?
Yes. One of my villagers also killed on the way.
Running and got shot?
Yeah.
Kasim was a school teacher in his home village where he can trace his family history back at least four generations.
My family is also the one of the brothers who were killed by the Burmese government.
So you're taking care of your brother's child, and sister-in-law, your brother's wife?
Yes.
How do you deal with this?
I love him very much. No, I am taking care of him. He is my daughter's child.
Why do you think that the Myanmar military did this?
The government trying the whole country to be Buddhist.
So this is a religious dispute?
Religious. It is the religious thing. They're trying to be Buddhist country. All will be Buddhist.
I heard several stories like this, claiming that the attacks were religiously motivated, Buddhist on Muslim, and calculated to drive out the Rohingya. No government confirms that story, but the Rohingya here believe it.
I had to leave my children in the midst of firing and chaos. What could I do?
So she was in her home when the military of Myanmar showed up. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
What happened to the village?
The village was burned. As the houses were set on fire, a lot of the people could not get out. Some were hacked to death or their bodies were lit on fire. Little children were thrown away violently.
How did you get separated from your two children?
In Myanmar, our home was attacked suddenly by gunfire. That moment, I escaped through an open door and I grabbed one of my children who was close to me. Soon I saw my whole house was on fire. I do not know what happened to the others. There was no way to know who was shot or who was butchered. I could not find out.
I just can't even imagine how hard this is. I almost don't know what to say to you. I'm at a loss for words.
My son was 5. My daughter, 7.
What's her name, in case anyone is watching?
Shahida.
And what is what is your son's name?
Mahmoud al-Hassan.
So for now, the new home for the Rohingya is in neighboring Bangladesh, the Kutupalong refugee camp. What was once a lush forest is now a sprawling slum that reaches out for miles.
I had no idea how big it was going to be, so seeing just how huge the camp was, just on and on and on with all of the people, that was kind of my first impression, was just the huge scope of it. Like, I'd heard about it, you see the statistics, you see the numbers, but to be here in person and seeing how extensive it is, that's something completely different. Like, once you get in, besides just looking at the physical stuff, looking at like the people, the feel of the camp when I walk through it, there's just this sense of a lot of people that are just kind of surviving, not really living, just kind of getting by day to day.
An initial settlement of refugees already existed here, but after the violence in August of 2017, the camp started to grow by enormous numbers. When they arrived, the Rohingya had no homes, no shelters, no source of heat for cooking. But what the land held was trees. And one by one, they were cut down. The trees that held the hillsides became campfires and shelters that now stretch to the horizon. Kaylin Briggs is an American who has worked in 5 countries in the last 5 years. She is now with World Vision, a relief agency which is active here. She has seen the growth.
When we had this massive population influx last August, We had to expand the area where those people were living. So what we're in now is called the expansion camp. So it's basically a much larger camp that's built sort of around the original site.
All right. Well, any idea what the population of the expanded camp is? About
it's over 600,000.
Of the expanded camp, that would include the original camp too?
That doesn't include the original camp.
So, oh, it does not?
No. So if you include the original camp and all of the little bits around it, we're up to around 900,000 people. So this is the largest refugee camp in the world.
But they are cut off. They cannot leave the camp. Officially, the Bangladesh government has even put restrictions on the sale of SIM cards to refugees for their cell phones, citing security precautions. Formal education is not allowed. Some organizations sponsor language lessons for children, but not in the local trade language, Bengali. Though there is little to do, there are few sources of entertainment. No television, limited internet, and only weak radio signals with little information in the Rohingya language. Since refugees don't have work permits, they are officially not allowed to have jobs. It's fertile ground for the breeding of extremists and terrorism.
We often say in these types of emergencies that idleness is one of the biggest threats. When people have too much time, when they don't have the opportunity to work or do things, that's when we start seeing risks go up in camps.
Kids are kids, and they try to keep busy. And while the Rohingya may not be able to fill proper jobs, it doesn't stop them from working. You do find some computers in use here and there. But I'm told that their usage also requires permission from authorities in the camps. So no work, no schooling, no movement, not much of a life. No one, not governments, not relief workers, and least of all the Rohingya themselves, knows how long they will be here and when or if they will ever be able to return home. And there's more. Another pressing, potentially disastrous enemy has come to the Rohingya.
ဒီစီစဉ်ကိုတင်ဆက်တဲ့ Greater Van Sestrin ဟာစက်တင်ဘာလ26ရက်နေ့မှာပဲရိုဟင်ဂျာတွေပေါ်လူမျိုးတုံးတပ်ဖြတ်မှုလို့ခေါင်းစဉ်ပေးထားတဲ့အမေရိကန်အောက်လွှတ်တော်ကြားနာပွဲမှာသူခီးစဉ်နဲ့ပတ်သက်ပြီးတော့ထွက်ဆိုခဲ့ရပါတယ်။ရခိုင်ပြည်နယ်ကအဖြစ်အပျက်တွေအကြောင်းသတင်းရေးသားတင်ပြရတဲ့သတင်းထောက်တွေဘယ်လောက်ဖိအားနဲ့အခက်အခဲကြုံရရဲဆိုတာကိုလည်းလွှတ်တော်ကြားနာပွဲမှာသူကရ